start with a pledge of allegiance, please. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Minutes were sent out ahead of time. Any changes, additions, corrections to it?
Make a motion for approval.
We have a motion from Ron Smith to approve. We have a second. Of King People Shoes.
Bobby said it.
Bobby Simpson seconded. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions? So carried. Treasurer's report. Dave Allen.
Reports are mailed out. Week or two ago. Just got the statements for last month today, so I'll be finishing that up and we'll get the year-end results to the account.
Did you do the spend down? Did you get all the money spent down, so that was all taken care of? Correspondence. Enforcement list. Andrew Lessie from New York, suspended for 1 year effective June 9th, 2016. 6 months actual suspension served concurrently with his restricted status. The remaining 6 months are stayed, placed on probation for 1 year effective March 20th, 2017. Assessed a civil penalty of $2,000. Of that amount, half is stayed. Required to truthfully testify at any future department hearings. For violations of 10, part 800.16A4. Letter from Department of Health from Joe Farrell, Senior Emergency Medical Care Representative, notifying us that Edward Fire Department Rescue Squad, their ambulance code was deactivated, and then one indicated that an agency code has been activated for them to become a BLS-FR. We have a letter from Governor Volunteer Fire Company asking letter of intent to become BLSFR and looking for support for that. And this was forwarded, and I assume they're working with you, Mark, because you forwarded the letter to me, so it's not a surprise there. Any other correspondence? Moving on. SEMSCO and CMAC. Jim, no meeting, correct? Next meeting's in
May. Next meeting in May.
We will come back to Ann in just a minute for a REMAC and program agency. Executive committee, we did again work on the spend down, so that has been completed. Training and Ed, Debbie Foltz.
Training and Ed met very briefly today. We discussed the regional training plan that was submitted to the state on the number of courses that are going to be taught 18, 19 year. We talked about course sponsorships, doing stats on like pass fails, highest scored areas, lowest scored areas. We covered that. And the last thing that we talked about was course sponsorship renewals, which is Jefferson Community College and Jefferson County EMS's renewals are up and due by June 30th, and asked if we could possibly get the renewals to review June 1st so that we could bring it up at the June meeting. That's the end of my report.
Very good. CON, Ron?
Nice and quiet.
Okay. If you recall the last meeting, we had a discussion about the CON process and what was discussed at the state level, and a lot of the emphasis was placed on we need regions to have a good CON process. They need to make sure it meets their needs, that we're going to take our 6 or 7 page one and go down to a 1 page, and we're just going to give you some basic guidance. So I spoke with Karen Taddeo and asked her to put together a cost to sit down with the CON committee and go through our process and make sure everything is good and really define it well. And at the same time, John had suggested if they were coming up that maybe we do some training as well. So she has given us a price to do, review the CON and transfer process policy, and then also a half-day mock trial that includes the need of proper PCR completion and do the trial and do a PowerPoint, and for everything it would be $4,500. So I'd like your input on that, whether you think we should do this. My thought was perhaps we could maybe do it in June and maybe do the CON committee in the morning, early afternoon, and then do the training like from 6 to 9 at night or something, because I know weather gets nice, everybody, your weekends are limited, and we don't have that much of good weather, so people don't want to give up their weekend time.
Is the intent for her to write policies for us?
The intent is for her to review our policies, make sure everything
because
is what it needs.
If they're doing away with that policy, shouldn't we in the CON committee then come up with policies for her to review? Aren't we getting the cart before the horse here?
The thought was that we need to make sure we stay in compliance with what was there, so the thought was that she could help us from the beginning. If you'd rather wait, we can certainly do that, but
I personally would rather wait and have the CON committee sit down and come up with some stuff for our region and then let her review and sit down with us and say why we're wrong or it's a good policy or because what we may be doing may be different than Central New York. I hate to have, you know, one policy fits all.
My understanding when Lee went over this was more of a clarification. We can adopt the current policies that we've been following. What was happening was people were saying, that's New York State telling us to do this. But it was, we could take 0606 and 90, well, whatever they are.
0606.
Whatever they are.
Heard.
Okay. We can adopt those. If we put those on, that those are the policies we're going to follow to approve CONs, then that's perfectly fine. But we, each region had to adopt the policy or adopt a policy as to what they're going to follow, so there was something for state to come back and compare it to. And so you still can use those same ones you've been using. You can write new ones, you can modify them. But it's not that New York State is doing away with them. They're narrowing it down and saying, we're giving guidelines because that's all we can do. But those policies can be regulation for REMAC if you so adopt them, or excuse me, REMSCO if we so adopt them.
The key thing.
I guess my line of thinking would be stay with what we've already got from the state and add two for areas that are lacking in that 0606 policy statement. Because the policy 0606 doesn't cover all situations. And I'm not sure that we can write something that will cover all situations, but I think it could very easily be expanded, then let Karen go through and say why.
What is the thought of the council?
Deb, can I just interject here? Why this has happened is that basically our policy statement has been used for appeal process. And the department that's not, you need to have a little better separation of church and state, if you will, from those sort of things. You certainly can do what Ron is suggesting and not 0606. However, I think you'll begin in this new world of looking at this. There's a lot of places there that need to be beefed up. As an example, one example comes to mind, the fee schedule.
The what schedule?
The fee schedules.
Right. And these need to be beefed up.
And I'm going to offer just adopting those may not make a lot of sense. Let me offer this. What's wrong with standardizing amongst councils and CON stuff? Especially if you got ones that go across to two or three council lines. Wouldn't it be nice if everybody was looking off the same piece of music?
That's what we've been doing now, so I guess I'm saying what's wrong with what we've got if it's beefed up.
I'm gonna offer you, darn, you, every, all four of my councils have different policy procedures and different ways of doing things. And frankly, one of the thoughts I'd offer is comparing notes and maybe doing this, so it's, as an example, if you've got it, you know, an example, when you've done Southern Oswego, you had to do crossovers with Central New York. You've had to do stuff with the council, and I can't remember, I just thought about the Mid-Lakes, but I can't remember the, you might want to think about comparing notes and maybe even sharing the costs of them doing it, so you've got it all in a combination document to lend itself across council lines. A lot of these complicated CONs become that. That's just a thought, but something you may want to think about.
I know there's a lot of variations, and the current Goal 6 does not cover all situations.
No, it does not.
In fact, it's lacking in many ways.
But again.
But Karen's about the most up-to-date person on these things.
Mark?
I think that it makes sense to use Karen for her longevity in this realm. When I first got into EMS management back in 1999, she's been kind of a staple from day one. I mean, she has a very reputable reputation in New York State for the CON process. So I think using what we have, which has been very good, combining it with her expertise and knowledge as an attorney and how she's always, I personally am not aware of her being unsuccessful. There may be a case that I don't know about, but I don't think she's ever been unsuccessful. So I think that it makes sense to bring the groups together and come up with a final document. I don't know that I have a preference one way or the other how we achieve that. I mean, things have changed so much in the last decade when it comes to CONs. It may be prudent to combine what we have, which is good, with her experience and expertise into a new document that will move us into the future that perhaps has been the case with our CON here that other councils will adapt on to. We've been kind of the leader in the CON arena, much thanks to Ron, but bring those together with something new and useful.
Who would be working with Karen on the CON?
Pardon me?
Who would be working with Karen on the CON?
The CON committee and myself. I'll be sitting next to you.
That could be dangerous.
I'm thinking out of this, that could be.
If that's what you want to do, that's fine. I just thought that if we had something kind of put together first, walking in, and then let her look at it and say, okay, this is wrong. Yes.
But you kind of have that now. Starting point. You have that now. So that could be your starting point. What you already have could be your starting point. My goal is for every committee to get some detailed stuff together so that we could have a smooth succession plan as some of us are getting older and some of us are going to get ready to say it's time to hand the baton to the next one, that we have good foundation for this council to remain strong and be able to continue on. And I think that that's one of the most important committees that we have, and I just, you know, with what they were saying at State Council just made me kind of like, we really need to tackle this sooner rather than later. But that's just my personal take. That's why I got the quote and I'm bringing it to you folks to say yay or nay.
I think you should take what we're currently using, give it to Karen and work with it.
I think you gotta look at it after the regional council and all the members, and she's the best one to help us so we stay out of trouble.
She's done. Our hearing officer is also good. I can't think of his name right now.
Out of Albany?
Hmm?
Out of Albany.
The father and son?
Hannigan.
Hannigan, thank you.
Very good, too. I don't know who's better, I, you know. You probably know better than I do.
Don't ask him that.
I know you can't answer that. For both of us.
I make a motion that you take the license chair and contact the attorney and work with the program agency to come up with a good document for CON.
I'll second.
Also, we have the, I don't know, what about the half-day training opportunity?
That too, put that in.
So the total cost was $4,500 to work with the CON committee and make sure that we have a good written process and to enhance what Ron has already got in place. We're just looking at enhancing that. And then doing a mock trial training that we would open to the region for a cost of $4,500.
That mock trial is in front of the whole council or just for the CON committee?
No, the training for the whole region.
For the whole region, get continuing ed hours that we need.
Because my thought was that perhaps we could get the DA for the county that's now retired. Maybe she would be the defense counsel and we could get some people to do some PCRs and actually, we harp and harp on documentation and it would be a nice opportunity for people to see why it is as important as we say it is and what could happen when you don't have it good in place.
I'm going to offer, they did a mock trial a few years ago down at Utica one night of their trauma teaching and it was excellent. It was just excellent. I think everybody's eyes got opened up. It was not something until you've been there and the attorney kind of way after you on the work and stand. They can do that. Oh, yes, they can.
Now, for the mock trial, to get the turnout that you'd like to see, wouldn't that be better for a spring forward type thing? Would be too late to do for now? For the current one?
We can certainly look at that, but that, I don't think it needs to be tied to that. We could certainly.
I'm thinking for the turnout. If you're going to spend money, don't you want the biggest turnout that you can get? You have a good turnout down there.
So we have a motion and a second to go ahead and proceed with this. We can certainly work out the details. We'll obviously have to work with the CON committee when you're available to sit down to do that. And we can certainly look at the date and that can be.
Would the meeting be here or Syracuse?
It'll be here. It'll be here. Yep.
If I have to go to Syracuse, I can.
No, it's going to be here. That's included in there. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Any abstentions?
I will abstain.
Okay.
Being CON chair, I will abstain.
Okay, we're going to go back to Ann.
All right, so I'm just going to kind of combine the RE/MAC REMSCO reports. So this is an update from last time. We talked about the different BLSFRs that we were working with. At that point, we had sent paperwork in. They're all completed with the exception of Morley Fire Department, but other paperwork's been sent in. We're just waiting to hear back. We accepted two new physicians. So that comes forth as a seconded motion to this body to approve Dr. Coates and Dr. Fink as RE/MAC physicians. So Dr. Coates is from Camp Potsdam Hospital, will be replacing Dr. Lawrence, and Dr. Fink is the new ER director at Carthage Area Rescue. And at Carthage Area Hospital, and he is the agency medical director for Carthage Area Rescue. So that comes forth as a seconded motion.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions?
So medical director changes, it comes forth as a seconded motion to change Sackett's Harbor Fire Department and St. Lawrence University BLSR from their current medical directors to Dr. Maynard, and Fort Drum EMS from their current medical director, Dr. Wallace, to Dr. Thaddeus Pajak.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions?
In Beaver Falls, we approved the upgrade from the last meeting, still in process. I have not received narcotic license, and they have not notified me to do an inspections. They have contacted the office routinely with questions, so I do know that they are working on it. Those are the current public access defibrillations that we've received, Carthage Central School, Charter Communications in Watertown, and First Presbyterian Church in Watertown. Due to the changes in public health law, I'll no longer need be required to report the epinephrine notice of intents. So it comes forth as a seconded motion to this body to approve the following BLS adjuncts. For Sackett's Harbor, BLS Narcan, Albuterol, CPAP, and blood glucometry. And for Morristown Volunteer Fire Department, BLS glucometry, all their paperwork is in order.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions?
Two or three meetings ago, we approved Waddington Rescue for BLS blood glucometry. I'm still waiting on their limited lab. I'll be doing a Harrisville inspection on their new fly car tomorrow. Brownville, I'll be doing an inspection on the 13th. Herman Fire Department, it comes forth due to concerns on their plan of correction. Following inspection, it comes forth as a seconded motion to downgrade their level of care to BLS.
Any questions on that? All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions?
Just update on EPCR agencies as we move forward. Cape Vincent's the newest one to go live on 3-1, and we still have Star Lake, Wellesley Island, Sackett's Harbor, Natural Bridge in process. Beaver Falls has been sent the information. So again, it's just the only change to that list from last time is Natural Bridge and Cape Vincent going live. Since we rolled out the new protocols, we've had 169 EMTs register on the site. We've had 78 folks that have been validated this year. We're still waiting on a lot of cards. We'll start sending reminder notices out because to be validated, we have to receive their card and that has to be on file in the office. There's the numbers for spring fling, which may be on the agenda elsewhere, but we're about 200. They completed or helped out with the training for Claxton Hepburn Medical Center for First Responders Training Day on March 4th. It was successful. We had 22 providers. And on February 23rd, I did a Narcan training in Three Mile Bay. So you really don't want me to read those numbers, do you?
No.
You guys all can read right now. Everybody good?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Whoops, that slide didn't hide. Upcoming training, spring fling. So one of the more exciting things is this New York State Coverdell program that will improve communication, performance, quality improvement activities. What this is the Coverdell Stroke Group has put out a pilot program where we can, they will actually build a regional bridge for us to keep data in. They will provide incentive for agencies that are not electronic to be electronic, as well as maybe some funding for those that can map to this regional bridge. Hopefully this will give us some better data to work with. And you had to have a Coverdell stroke participating hospital within your region. We did not. We partnered with Susquehanna region, Mid-State, Central New York, and the North Country. So we're kind of the same group that falls under the Central Field Office. And they had four proposals and only had two awards to give out. And after I wrote the initial proposal, collaborated with the partners to get the data. Susie did a follow-up proposal when they wanted clarification questions, and we were awarded it. So with that being said, the benefits of participation for the program agency, again, it goes back to the data that we're going to get, hopefully, when this is all done and said and built. The benefits for the EMS agencies, I'm just going to skip to the slide because that's a little easier, is there is going to be some monetary incentive for them to participate. And what I'm going to ask from all of you is, once I get more information and we start reaching out to these agencies, is I'm going to need your support to support this program. So, and help get their commitments, because there's going to be kind of a tight timeline here, I think, with the funding. So, and these are just, you know, we had to sign a commitment that we would participate. This program's going to go on until 2020. We'll be bringing some data back here, providing some stroke data out to the agencies, but recruiting the EMS agencies to participate in this program is what I'm going to be asking you guys for. So, and we'll have some more data, like I said. Whoops, those are old slides. So the other seconded motion that I have to bring forth to you is, we reviewed all the policy statements and created new policy statements that were needed due to the change in protocols, and they were all sent out for you for review. They were all approved with the noted changes. So that comes forth as a seconded motion to approve the updated policy statements and the new policy statements that were sent out to you with noted changes.
Do you want the policies pulled up to look at them and vote on them one by one? Do you have any questions about a specific one that you would like pulled up? What is your preference on how to handle these?
I think there was enough of us at REMAC that unless somebody has a specific question, that we can move them through as a policy statement.
Do you want to make that a motion to vote on all of them?
Yes.
So we have a motion to vote on all the policy statements all at once. Do we have a second on that?
Second. Aye.
Sounds like that's what they want to do. So, all those in favor of approving the policy statements that have been sent out previous, say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions? Very good.
So the next seconded motion that I have is, the medical control manual was approved with some minor grammar corrections, like where it should say exist instead of exits. And I missed a PA, and to change the attestation statement to say provider instead of physician. I bring that forth as a seconded motion to approve the attestation statement. The medical control manual was corrected, and to remove the requirement for testing of medical control physicians.
So moved.
All those in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions?
Oh, the minimum equipment list that was sent out was approved with the changes, and including the change from cuff tubes, or from non-cuffed pediatric tubes to cuffed pediatric tubes. That would be phased in as tubes expire throughout the year. And then to replace them all at the end of the year, to give the agencies time to do that, as there's a recommendation now to use cuffed pediatric tubes.
Mark, do you want to give a little background on that? What you've been, you know, you change them out and what you've been told in Syracuse, so that people know that.
Essentially, from a 3-0 and up, the preference nowadays is cuffed endotracheal tubes. Both the PICU in Burlington and Syracuse, which that's where, that's the two tertiary care centers for us are, is their preference. When it becomes most problematic is when you're ventilating an infant and you don't have a cuff tube, you get a fair amount of air leak on a mechanical ventilator. It just becomes extremely problematic. And that's, you could go on with a long discussion with other things, but that's really the major, I think, discussion point. So we have come in the air industry to the point where some PICU attendings have even asked our crews to exchange for the transport. That's how adamant they are that they want to come to.
Any questions? All those in favor of approving the minimum inventory list with that change and the changes that were sent to you previously, say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions?
Okay, and just for the record, we did table any change with the CME evaluator, so I will have to get notification out to the agencies with the protocol rollout and review of all these policy statements. I really haven't had time to work on that project. So we're going to table it at least until next semester, and I had previously notified that everybody would have to be recredentialed this semester. So I'll have to get notification out to everybody regarding that. That completes my report. Any questions for the program agency?
And I have a couple of questions relative to REMAC. And I was going to ask them in REMAC, but we were so pressed for time that I didn't want to be the guy to prolong things. And even here, we got in here like at 3 minutes of 7 to start. But one is, you in all of my going through all the podcasts and the material that I've seen, and maybe I missed it, but I think that it's important. In the in-house update that I did at Lewis County Search and Rescue, one of the things that I emphasize that I think is important that from a safety perspective is we have always, forever, we've used premixed dopamine, which is all labeled, etc. We're moving to Levofed and epinephrine drips, and those are medicines that we're mixing in the field in the ambulance. And while it seems like really mundane, to me, it's a huge, one of the things that I do at work now is I'm the safety rep, so I'm constantly, my brain kind of focuses on safety. But from a safety perspective, I think the agencies need to be super reminded the importance of getting the little orange sticker from the pharmacy and putting that with your Levofed or your epinephrine and making sure that these 1,000 bags, because for whatever reason, the collaborative group chose 1,000 bags of saline for these to be mixed in. I can foresee in my brain like that worst case scenario in a busy, we gotta start a Levofed drip because somebody's blood pressure is 60 over 40 and they mix it, they hang it, they don't tag it, and then the blood pressure is like maybe 70 over 40 at the ER, and the ER nurse flips that baby open, and now they're getting Levofed wide open. That's, so I say all that to say, I think that that should be somehow
communicated
out just as that little safety thing, you know, even if it's a piece of tape, if you don't have that nice little orange pharmacy sticker, a piece of tape that says, Levo 4 milligrams and 1,000, or Epi 1 milligram and 1,000. I think that that's an important thing that we should be communicating out. The second thing is more of a question that I'm not sure that I've encountered, that I just got asked yesterday, and I said, hey, I'm going to REMAC and REMSCO. Maybe somebody else has put thought into this. We're in a situation in Lewis County where I still volunteer, where Dr. Howland's going to Messina, graciously He's gonna stay on as our medical director until we can find a replacement. Our backup is also leaving. Loudville now has this NES physician group, so there's transition frequently. The new ER director replacement is willing to participate, but he wants to be compensated. And it's my understanding, based on that clause in Article 30, if that individual is compensated, then their protection under Article 30 goes away. I'm just wondering, but, and I can be wrong, and that's why I'm bringing it here. I'm wondering, is there any other, like, I know a bunch of folks here, is there anyone here that compensates their medical director? Okay, so you guys would be, I don't want to belabor the point, but I knew this would be the easy forum, so I can turf Justin to Raleigh, Dave for food for thought. And I think as we move forward, I think medical directors are going to be less likely to continue to volunteer in these capacities, particularly when you have training.
And we also compensate our regional medical directors. So.
I knew that.
I'll offer Mark to the Central Sub-Region. 5 years ago, no one got compensated. Today, significant percentage, and I don't know what that is, but it is a significant percentage. The big thing that is not only just the monetary compensation, it's the vehicles that they want to drive and put red lights and sirens on to respond to scenes that now add to your baseline corporate liability for workman's comp and so forth. It's riders on their malpractice insurance that they want paid, and it gets, there are a lot of costs there that people don't realize. One of the physicians in Syracuse who came from Texas, all the Texas medical directors are paid because in the state of Texas, that's the only way you get the NALS service. There is no REMAX, there is not. So it's out there. It's out there quite a bit.
Thank you. Thanks.
Anything else for Ann? Moving on to the point I know everybody has been waiting for, the bylaw committee. So we're going to pull them up here, and the committee members, and Dave Sherman as the secretary has the voting for each one. So starting with Article 1, the change there, the name of the organization, everybody should have had these, you had a chance, there's a few in blue that we'll discuss. They came about from people that submitted things back to us. We appreciate that. The things that we did get back, the bylaw committee met again, and we adopted some of those, and we put those in here. So, Article 1. All those in favor? We need to raise a hand.
Raise your hand so we can count. We got to have a...
Oh, really?
Yeah, really.
We got a...
Tell me what your count is, Dave.
Or actually, let's try it this way. Those opposed.
Yeah, it's easier to say opposed than abstain. So I already got a count of how many members we have. So there's no opposed?
Every single one. Good.
No opposed. Any abstain? No abstain. That means 22 yes.
Okay. Article 2. Section 2. Noes? Abstains?
Makes 22 yes.
Article 2, Section 3. Noes? Abstains?
22 yes.
Article 3, Section 1. Noes? Abstains?
22 yes.
Article 3, Section 2. Elimination of that. Noes.
That is the reference to Article 30, that number.
Pardon me?
That number in Article 2, in number 2 is what we're eliminating, that 303-2 is the reference to Article 30.
Correct. Noes? Abstains?
Page 22, yes.
Section 3. Article 3, Section 3. Noes? Abstains?
22, yes.
Article 3, Section 5. You see, we're changing the way the nominations go to get on the council, making it a council. Noes? Abstains?
Makes 22, yes.
Article 3, Section 6. There's a new proposal that we've added in. This was, and again, appreciate the people that gave us feedback, so add it in. There are no term limits for membership. At the end of any member's four-year term, he or she may request reappointment to the council. If the person is a member of a designated county position, they shall automatically be appointed to or replaced by the council upon written receipt notification from the county. Members whose category has changed may not be eligible to stay in the council if the council makeup does not meet our guidelines, Article 3, Section 1. 3 months prior to term expirations, the membership committee will advise those with expiring terms. So the concern is there that as some of us age out, we no longer are members of ambulances. We can't have the council be made up of members at large and have a small representation of the ambulances. So this gives us the ability to make sure that we keep the right makeup of the organization. Noes? Abstains?
22, yes.
Article 3, Section 7. Noes? Abstains?
22, yes.
Article 3, Section 8. Noes? Abstains?
22, yes.
Article 3, Section 9. This has had some addition put into it. So it will now become 7 from 9, but the proposal change is prospective members and current council members must be what the general community would consider to be a good citizen. A misdemeanor or felony conviction may be grounds for immediate removal. The member will, in writing, notify the chair within 5 days of conviction. Misdemeanor was added because when we looked at the form that you fill out to take an EMT class, it is in there as well. And we felt that there should be a timeline of when they would notify us that they had been convicted of such so that the council can decide whether they can stay a member or not. Noes? Abstains?
22, yes.
Article 3, Section 10. Noes? Abstains?
22, yes.
Article 4, Section 1. So what we've done is we have taken and we have taken the terms and put two people that are appointed on odd years and two that are appointed on even years so that we would have some continuity of the organization so that all the officers wouldn't change at once. So that continuity could be there to make sure things run smoothly. Noes? Abstains?
22, yes.
Article 4, Section 2. Noes. Abstains?
22 yes.
Number 4, we have a new proposal. Nominations from the floor will be accepted at the annual meeting, which shall be held in April prior to the election of each position. Noes. Abstains?
22 yes.
Number 5. Noes? Abstains?
I got a question. How do you handle that the first year? If you're, oh yeah, it's for 2 years, I'm sorry. I was reading the old one.
Noes? Abstains?
22 yes.
Okay, on to Section 5. Number 1. Noes? Abstains?
22 yes.
Article 5, Section 2. Noes? Abstains?
22 yes.
Article 5, Section 3. Noes? Abstains?
22 yes.
Okay, Section 4, it was recommended that we take and bullet the responsibilities of the treasurer. So that's what we have done. That's the new proposal. So it's now, we took all the items up above and we just bulleted them. It was thought that that would be easier to read. So we did that. They're all the same ones there. They're just bulleted. Yeah, formatting change. Yep. Any questions on that? Noes? Abstains?
22 yes.
Okay, Section 6 is an add. Noes? Abstains?
22 yes.
Section 7, a new proposal. In the event of a vacancy of any office, the members of the council will be advised of the vacancy as soon as possible via electronic means, postal mail, or other acceptable method. Election to fill said vacancy will occur at the next scheduled meeting with nominations from the floor and those voting members in good standing. The newly elected officer will fill out the remainder of the term. So we added in all the different ways that you could be notified of said voting. Any questions on that? Noes? Abstains?
22 yes.
Article 6, Section 1. It was recommended that this get reworded because it sounded like there was more meetings. So we reworded it to, the regular meetings of the council shall be held at least quarterly on the first Monday of the month unless otherwise ordered by the council or executive committee. There will be no less than 4 meetings per year. Any questions on that? Noes? Abstains?
22 yes.
Number 2, Article 6, Section 2. Noes? Abstains?
22 yes.
Article 6, Section 3. Noes. Abstains.
22 yes.
Article 6, Section 4. Any questions on that? That is a little different. Noes. Abstains.
22 yes.
Article 6, Section 5. Deleting. Noes. Abstains.
22 yes.
Article 6, Section 7. Noes. Abstains.
22 yes.
Okay, Article 7, Section Title. So it will no longer be called Conflict of Interest, it will be called Council Ethics Guidelines. Noes. Abstains.
22 yes.
Section 2. Noes. Abstains.
22 yes.
Article 7, Section 3. Noes. Abstains.
22 yes.
Article 7, Section 4. New proposal has been added to this one, number 8. Suspected violations of council members should be brought to the chair or vice chair and reviewed by the executive committee. Substantiated violations would be grounds for dismissal from the council. Noes? Abstains?
22 yes.
Okay. Article 8, Section A1. Noes? Abstains?
22 yes.
Article 8, Section A2. Noes? Abstains?
22 yes.
Article 8, Section A4. Noes? Abstains?
22 yes.
Article 8, Section B1. Noes? Abstains?
22 yes.
Article 8, Section B3. Noes? Abstains?
22 yes.
Article 8, Section B4. Noes? Abstains?
22 yes.
Article 8, Section B5. Noes. Abstains?
22 yes.
Article 8, Section B6. This is a new proposal. The membership committee shall advertise for, receive, and review letters of intent, applications, and resumes for filling council vacancies. The membership committee shall present these applications to the council and make its recommendations as specified in Article 3. The membership committee shall review attendance records of each member prior to each regular meeting to determine if the requirements are fulfilled as specified in Article 3. The committee shall perform such other related duties as determined by the chair. Any questions on that? Noes. Abstains.
two yes.
Article 8, Section B, 7. Noes. Abstains.
22 yes.
Article 8, Section B, 8. Noes. Abstains.
22 yes.
Article 8, Section B, 9. Noes. Abstains.
22 yes.
A new one that has been added. Number 10, Auditing Committee. The Auditing Committee shall consist of a chair and at least two members, one from each county, whom shall be responsible for ensuring financial integrity of the council. The Auditing Committee will review the financial statements of all accounts associated with the council monthly. They will provide a written report at each meeting of their findings, and they will become part of our month meeting minutes. They will work closely with our auditor slash accountant and ensure that their recommendations, when appropriate, are implemented and their policies and procedures are in compliance with all state and federal laws. Members of the executive committee may not serve on the auditing committee. Any questions on that? Noes. Abstain.
22 yes.
Almost there, guys. Section B6, that's just a change in the number. Noes. Abstains.
22 yes.
Section B11. Noes. Abstains.
22 yes.
Section 9. Noes. Abstains.
22 yes.
Section 10, eliminate the flow chart. Noes. Abstains.
22-10, or yes. Getting tired! 22-10, that's a lot.
The new Article 10 is the indemnification, all the legal jargon that we're supposed to have in there. Noes. Abstains.
22 yes.
The last one is Article 11, talking about investments of the organization. Noes. Abstains.
22 yes.
There's
the entire thing is voted yes, unanimously, by default count.
The bylaw committee is going to stay together. We're going to work on the application to join the council and get that done, and then the thought process is that it would be available on the website so that people could go to it to download the application as openings become available, so that it would be accessible and the proper verbiage and that we need to be in compliance will all be in there. The council or the committee also thought we should look at a couple things. The first one was at the recommendation of our current treasurer. He thought we should look at the cost of bonding the officers. And I did get a quote on that. Just gotta see where I put it in all this pile of stuff I just had in front of me. Director and officers insurance for $1 million coverage with a $250 deductible. The cost is $1,072 annually, and that was quoted with three different carriers. The bonding coverage, what the bonding coverage is if somebody should embezzle funds, it covers that for $75,000 worth of bonding coverage. with a $500 deductible. The cost is $636 a year, or if we up the deductible to $1,000, the cost is $576 a year. So any thoughts on that?
That seems very steep to me, because we bond our staff, and it's a quarter of that.
Yeah, ours is too, search and rescue.
It is, but there you have paid positions that are handling the funds. This is bonding 30 volunteers.
Well, the other factor is we had an existing insurance policy, so it was a rider on it.
Right, and ours is too, it's ours. I quoted, I got three different quotes from three different, those were the best.
Can we have to bond the...
Everybody?
Everybody, can we just bond the executive committee? I'm just thinking, outside the executive committee, who really deals with funds? I don't know if it would be cheaper.
Have we just done executive insurance for the County Firefighter Association, it was $250.
It went amount?
Yeah, off the top of my head, I could go back again. Well, the other factor is if you're doing an auditing committee every month, now you've got less exposure. So that's something to consider too. It's always a good idea to have some protection.
We're looking down the road, we wanted to get you, bad things can happen.
Oh, he's the one that brought it up.
Right. I told you you were safe until we hit a million, and we never hit a million, so you were good with me. But. Food for thought, I guess.
I just think that we should look at the executive committee and those folks that are actually going to be handling money per se. And
just quote from that. Same checks.
And then maybe those people in that audit and finance committee as well, if that's the case.
They're not handling money, though.
All they're doing is looking at the books, right?
Yeah.
Making sure of everything.
Yeah, because I thought of that first, too, is maybe we should cover them, but they're not really...
A lot of places just bond their treasurer. They don't bond those rest of the offices.
All right, I'll get some more information to bring back to the June meeting.
People handling money, that's the main of the treasurer. Well, there's other people who complain.
Exactly, well, that's,
The other thing that you had approved in with the bylaws was we want to back up all of our treasurer's information. So, Carbonite, for a year worth of coverage, the basic coverage, which is all we need, we don't have that much information, would be $59.99 a year.
Good deal.
Yeah, good deal. Can I make a motion on that?
So can I have a motion to...
I'll make that motion. That's a good deal.
Okay. I will get that taken care of. Thank you to Ron and Bobby and Debbie.
Call for a vote on the motion.
Pardon me?
Call for a vote.
Oh, sorry. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions? Thank you for people's help on that. Again, thank you to the people that sent back some input to help make it better. County reports. Jefferson.
The emergency medical service specialist position in Jefferson County is still open. Jefferson County is putting on with Lewis County a core EMT course. It's going to be offered in turn beginning April 8th and ending May 4th. Jim Devers is the CIC. You can contact Judy or Jen Lewis County to register. And as of right now, there's 12 people registered for that CME research. Jefferson County EMS fall courses, the EMT course will be starting August 22nd and testing December 21st. The EMT refresher will be starting September 6th and will be testing December 21st. And the CFR course will be starting September 26th and testing 12/21. The CIC CLI update at Spring Fling is April 28th from 8 a.m. to 4 p.m. You'll register, if anybody else is interested, you'll register online at the North Country EMS Program Agency website. And while I was thinking of this, we've had a few calls in the office of people that have taken their instructor course, test, their instructor exam, and passing it, thinking that that means they never have to do anything else again. CICs and CLIs still need to take their updated courses.
And teach at least one class every 3 years.
Yes, one class every 3 years, but they thought they did not have to take updated classes anymore.
No, not true.
Public health, Jefferson County Public Health participated in a statewide tabletop flu drill on March 7th. So that's Jefferson County EMS's report. Any questions?
Carol, St. Lawrence County.
We have a short session. We had our election of officers, and essentially everybody stayed the same. I'm still chair, Mark is still vice chair, and Ann is still secretary. Leadership committee meeting is upcoming April 25th. And in June, there will be an Airbus disaster drill. It'll involve several hospitals from all around. And Claxton, like Ian said, held a responder training early in March. And we're still waiting for Dr. Coates to get his information back to us to be our medical committees. And that's it.
Did anybody, did Bob leave his information with anybody?
Yes. I still serve as an EMS deputy, so Bob had asked that I, basically just a couple of quick things. Bob's away for a few days and couldn't be here. In Lewis County, the EMS council approved this year to join in. They have, it started a couple of years ago, the Elks Lodge does a first responders banquet. And this year, for the first time, they're doing a combined banquet with law enforcement, fire, and EMS into a first responders banquet that's being hosted by the local Elks Lodge. That's May 6th. That should be good. Debbie already referenced the CME course that Jim is teaching in turn. The other thing that Bob has spent a fair amount of time too is he's done several, and I know he has a couple more educational, community educational seminars to the public where he's been part of this consortium. Teamed up with district attorney as well as Mountain View Prevention Services and Credo in educating the public regarding the opiate crisis and epidemic that's kind of widespread across the country, but has hit Lewis County pretty hard in the last 6 months or so.
Questions? Jim, do you have anything you'd like to add from the dispatch center? Old business, the advanced airway training site update. The contract has all been signed. Dr. Delaney, her resume had to be sent in, as well as Ann. Ann is going to be the administrator for the program, so their resumes have been sent in. I've done everything except we've got like 4 or 5 questions left that need to be answered. And working with Ann and the RSI committee, they need to know what we're going to charge for the classes and some of that stuff. And then we can get the class scheduled and figure out whether they're going to come here or they're going to go down there. So you'll see some emails coming out in the next few weeks asking if people are interested in becoming instructors. In order to become an instructor, you have to take the class first. So small steps here, so we'll get the class scheduled, and then we can take the next step. We did pay them $2,500 under last year's budget, so the initial payment to become the site has all been sent in. Next is election of officers. Raleigh.
The nominating committee is ready to offer the following officers for the chair, Debbie Singleton, vice chair, has made a snafu in our nominating committee, Mark Devers, and also Jake Gannett. Secretary unopposed is Jay Sherman, and treasurer, we have no nominations for that position.
And we'll discuss that in a minute. So you bring back, you're bringing forth two names for?
Vice chair.
Vice chair. Okay, so we're going to need some paper and ballots to be able to vote. Get some bigger paper there. So, when Mark decided to run for vice chair, he recused himself and came off the committee, sent me an email. Raleigh called me and we immediately, that was done, and Carol came on to fill the term, which the other people had already expressed interest, but we didn't want anybody to think there was anything. So when Mark decided he was interested, he recused himself as a member of the nominating committee.
Thank you. 22 ballots.
I don't know, I'm just ripping to take one around.
She's just tearing into it, she'll count later. Fair enough.
So, can you run the elections here, Raleigh? You start with chair. You have to ask three times if anybody else is.
I'll give it my best.
Paper's still coming around.
So for chair, Debbie Singleton.
This is just being held right now in case there's other people. I'm sure nobody writes Debbie on the until there's a lesson. Folks, hold the ballot for now. Correct.
Any nominations off the floor for the chair? Any nominations off the floor for the chair? Any nominations off the floor for the chair?
Make a motion that the secretary pass one ballot for the president of the chair.
So
I get two.
Thank you, Deb. Vice chair, we have two nominations on the floor now, Mark Devers and Jake Gannett. You have to sign a vote for those, and we'll count those after they come in back to me, I guess.
Yes.
Any
nominations
on the floor?
Carol, could you come over there, please?
I can.
And who was our...
For vice chair, is any nominations off the floor?
Sure, absolutely.
For vice chair, any nominations off the floor?
Motion to close the polls and move to vote.
Second.
Run the camera.
You need a sergeant in arms, and you need Mark Jimbo on either side. Kind of like. I'm here, you two.
Well, while they're counting that, I'll share a couple things with you. remember the last meeting, we gave you a spend down of the funds, and one of them was almost $3,200 to print up the protocol books, and I found them for $1,600, so that was why we had some more funds to spend down. So we did print, and we have 1,000 sheets, which is 2,000 copies of the physician on scene that was printed on cardstock. We're going to get to all the agencies so that if you have a situation, the physician shows up on scene, you just give them that card and all the pertinent information that you need to share with them is there. So we'll be getting those out to all the agencies. And we've already had one protocol change, and those have been reprinted. And then today we have another protocol. It's not the protocols really, it's just grammar things. So we have another thing that we need to have printed again. So we will get that printed as well. Raleigh?
Thanks, Steph. Mm-hmm. For the vice chair, 22 votes cast, 20 for Mark Devers, and 2 for Jay Gannett. Congratulations, Mark. Secretary,
yeah.
I don't think no. We have one name on the floor already, Dave Sherman. Is there any other nominations for secretary off the floor? Nominations for secretary from the floor. Nomination for secretary off the floor.
Make the motion that the ballot be closed. Cast one ballot.
The vice president, not the secretary. They can't cast a ballot for themselves.
What second?
The president has to cast a ballot.
Second. Congratulations, Dave.
Okay, as you heard him say, there were no nominations, so let's open it to the floor just in case. So the floodgates are going to open on treasurer. And then I'll share with you my backup.
There we go. Treasurer. Nominations. Are there any nominations for treasurer off the floor?
You don't sound pleading enough.
Nominations for treasurer off the floor.
You want to take
nominations for treasurer off the floor.
I'm going to be in and out.
Okay, there are no nominations from the floor. So at this time, I would like to go into executive session. And council members only can be in here, and the camera needs to be turned off.
All right.
Madam, you are back on the record.
Should I wear my Kevlar?
Back on the record, ma'am.
We're back on the record, and we're looking for a recommendation from the floor.
I'll make a motion that we hire the program agency to handle financial treasurer duties.
Second.
We have a motion on the floor and a second to hire Fort Drum Regional Health Planning Program Agency to handle our financial treasurer duties. All those in favor?
Point of order. Do we have discussion?
No. Discussion?
We should state what the amount is.
Okay. For a $50 a month fee?
Part of the motion.
Part of the motion. For $50 a month.
Part of the amendment.
Okay. And we should state also that Dave Allen has graciously agreed to stay on for a period of time, and that the nominating committee is going to stay active and try to get that position of treasurer filled, knowing that the duties and responsibilities have been lessened by the change that we're making here.
Just a technical question. Excuse me. Should the motion for the program agency and $50 fee be one, and then second to that, make a motion that Dave continue as an interim treasurer until there's a replacement?
Okay, yep, we can do it that way.
Just for
clarification.
Yeah.
Are you okay with that?
Yes.
Okay. So a motion and a second to hire FDRHPO program agency at a cost of $50 a month to assume the treasurer responsibilities. We have it.
You're there.
You already did.
Motion did.
I'm just stating the motion before you vote on it again. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed?
Now raise your hand.
Abstentions?
I'll make a motion that David Allen continue in his capacity as an interim treasurer until a replacement is found.
So Mark Tuttle made a motion, seconded by Carol, to keep Dave as treasurer, interim treasurer, until the position has been filled. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions? Very good. And once again, the nominating committee will stay active in hopes of filling the position.
I purposely put no term on that, you don't have to get her.
I called him on that too, so.
Okay, next thing. We need to approve the REMAC committee. This is from the applications that were received in, and so we have from Jefferson County, Dave Sherman for a one-year term, Janine Gomelia for a two-year, Jay Gannett for a two-year. Lewis County, Justin Astafan a one-year, Steve Mana a two-year, Mark Tuttle a two-year, Bob McKenzie a two-year. Bob as the county position. And for St. Lawrence County, Ken Gardner a one-year, Mark Devers a two-year, Bob Meyer a two-year.
Make the motion that we approve the nominations.
So we have a motion to accept the nominations for REMAC.
Second.
And we have a second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? So carried. Old business from the floor. Going on to new business. Mr. Morrissey.
I'll be quick. First, congratulations. Ms. Burns is thrilled to have you guys on board getting the CDA slash electronic charting project up and running. We thank you guys, along with the other program agencies. We'll be excited about that. Dr. Britton, who's also my area administrator, who covers all those 14 counties, has also had pledged his support in any way working with hospitals to make this work as he oversees those 14 counties. A couple of things. Party team permits. We're in the season. Folks got to have an ICS plan to accompany a party team permit. Now, why do I want that? Well, it tells me a lot of things, like who's in charge from law enforcement. And it's kind of important to know that, given we have multi-jurisdictions, who's going to be the lead agency. That's an example. Now, I'm not looking for a 50-page incident action plan for a small two-hour parade to get my drift. I'm not looking for it. However, if you've got a 10-day New York State Fair, you know, 14 days, guess what? I have about 50 pages to do to make that one work. So it fits the needs of the norm. The other thing is active shooter plans. Please, as you're looking at these, think through about other things other than just people with weapons of pistols and rifles. Cars are now being used. So thinking about coordinating with your police, about the coordination of that. Knives and guns, and swords are also now attacking things as we go through that, so I just mentioned that. Couple of things, budget. Ms. Burns announced at the State Council, I just want to reiterate, at the current rate of spending and the current proposed budget of the governor's office, which they still have not passed, and I somehow doubt our EMS program money is going to be what the assembly and the budget are fighting, the governor's fighting about currently. However, we will be probably running out of money in October or November. What that means is that there could be some changes in how we're funding different things. We are also down a number of staff. Our travel budget has been cut to near zero, and our support staff budgets are also cut. So it means that we are pretty lean at the moment trying to get things done as proposals. I should mention travel is overnight travel. As an example, for me to come up and go back that same day for a meeting is fine, but if I got to do overnights, that creates some issues for that. The Part 80 stuff, everything that we have sitting on our desk has been processed through to Albany. There are a number of the BCS folks are working through it, and they're chugging through getting permits and applications. If anybody's nervous or needs to know their status, call me, I can look it up on my, look it up on, and we'll take a look at it. All right, fentanyl and ketamine. If agencies are looking to add fentanyl or ketamine, they need to follow what's in the policy statements as how to obtain those. And you cannot carry them until you have a written letter back from Albany saying it's okay. Okay? Just because the new collaborative rules allow it, doesn't mean because you got an art certificate, you just walk up to your pharmacist and go get drugs. Okay? And that's happened in a couple of places that just haven't been fun when that occurred. Now, one thing about ketamine, there's two things I want to say about ketamine. One is, it's been determined that critical care can be a controlled substance officer for an agency that has ketamine. What has to happen is, it needs to be packaged separately than the other medications with a label that says paramedic only. You do not need to go buy additional lock devices, safes, and so forth for it. We've done a tremendous amount of questions related to this recently, I just share that with everybody, and do the long night here, I'll quick call it that, questions.
Is that it, Jim?
That's it.
Any questions? Okay, spring fling survey.
Just pull that away.
I realized that I hadn't sent it out after. I thought that it would be good to survey training and what people are doing in the region for training and what people feel they need in the region for training. So, so the first ones are just our standard, you know, primary, how long you've been a provider. That's it, it is. Find out if they're participating in the RESER program and mark all training that you currently have, and then answer the following about training in our region. Classes are offered on a regular basis. Classes are offered within my county. The majority of my training I receive at Spring Fling. Obtaining CME hours is easy. My region has enough instructors. My region has enough training supplies. And then mark all that you would be interested in attending so we can see where the ratio is and if there's things that we're not offering that the folks might like to have. I try to keep it kind of short so that people will complete it and give it back to us. And again, at the REMSCO booth, we will, I'll have little boxes there for them to mark how they vote on those. They will be eligible to be in a drawing to win a free Spring Fling 2018 registration. I encourage people to fill them out for us. The REMSCO, the booth has all been, got all the display stuff's all been printed, so that's all set, so we're good there. So, anything that, has anybody got a problem with kind of surveying that training and seeing what people want?
I don't have a problem with, are you doing the resuscitation program? Probably we should say CME resuscitation program.
Okay.
Shall we put that?
Resuscitation program.
There's a lot of confusion between regional.
And state.
And state.
Well, the state one is technically no longer called the CME program, but.
What is it now?
Recertification program.
Thank you, yeah. Recertification is called recertification through not, through continued medical education.
Right.
And that's the difference as opposed to regional CME.
So what were you saying, Andy? Something else?
Well, we have a lot of folks that are not from our region. So I think we have to put the region, are you from? We can share that with the other regional program agency directors if they would like.
Okay.
One other couple of areas I've put into questionnaires like this recently about if funding continues, what will happen to you or how will that affect your ability to have your certification? Again, I don't want to scare people, but it's not saying it's going away, but I'm just saying at the moment, that's where we are.
Those of us who are around in the 80s and 90s, there was no funding.
Right.
Agencies paid for it.
Yep.
Personally paid for it.
Yep.
Sure did.
This might be a question for John and the group. I know that a lot of programs, agencies are looking at, I mean, they do their conferences to also give CME hours to nurses, respiratory therapists, and the like. And we don't do that. And I don't know the process for that, but I think it's just a signature for the particular CIC doing the class.
Yeah, but the CIC has to have the credential for which you are granting that CME for. So in other words, let's say we wanted to give some CCRN or RN type credits. You have to have someone that is an RN slash, you know, presenter to take that on. And then typically through a hospital or university's continuing ed department, they work through that to get the accreditation so that they have the ability to give out the credits. And that's typically how it works for both. You'll see a lot for RNs, respiratory therapists. Actually, at a GEMS, they had a thing because they're now doing a lot of sonograms, so there was a lot of that stuff going on. There's a whole bunch of new things related to that. So,
John, if we have a lecture done by a physician,
okay. Well, it doesn't to get credits. It doesn't have to be always done by a doc. It can be done by other disciplines, but there has to be someone attesting to it. If you will, it follows a similar process to where we are. With the CME, with the state recertification program by CME, where we're saying you don't always have to have a CIC teaching like the non-core stuff. You can have another technical expert, okay? You could have, like, if somebody's doing anatomy physiology and you got a guy who's got a PhD in phys, but wouldn't know which side of the band-aid to put on a wound, you know what I'm trying to say? But I mean, that's a great, and that's acceptable. But let's say you're using that same physiologist for core content. You have to have the CIC validate that and or be on site and go through the process to make that work. So that's kind of how that works. We do a similar thing for our vital signs, okay, right. Which we use Cindy Tate out of California. There are other services like that around. And I think we pay so much a piece. How about this? I'm not exactly sure how it works, but there's a process of contracting that goes with that. I don't know exactly how it works, but there's a contracting piece.
Carol, I was just going to say a lot of times what they if the core content, what they're presenting, is sent to say New York State Education Department in the RN areas.
Okay.
They will say whether they will grant CEUs.
Okay, that's another way. I know a lot of hospitals, like in staff development, many hospitals and so forth do that quite routinely, and they have the ability themselves in-house to do that through accreditation. So, and as an example, SUNY does a lot of the ones you see downtown, Krause. One of the local hospitals may be willing to do it for spring cleaning, as an example, and just another way to help them. If there's somebody who's a nurse who's coming, to all counts, let's get them the credits.
I think it's a great idea. We can certainly put that on the agenda to look at for next year. Another revenue of getting folks there. So,
especially if if you tell the hospital, hey, we'll stamp your name on the brochure, they're willing to participate in things like that.
Yeah. It's just it's a win-win all the way around for their staff and for everything else. So it's just that is a great idea, Raleigh. It's something we haven't done, and it's so easy to do.
It is real difficult, I tell you, for nurses, especially if you're getting your national certification, and if you're renewing it and doing it in the courses, to get stuff up here. And we, a lot of times, have wonderful things presenting, but we can't get the credits.
Yeah, I mean, I've taught at a couple of the downtown stuff, and I've had to give my career, my CV and each outline of what I taught and reference objectives, and they've always gone through without too big a deal. I mean, it's just your presenters have to be aware of that when they are asked to present, so you've got the stuff together to do it. I'm speaking of the state chiefs, so I got to be in June, and I got to do the same thing for them, so that because they
Anything else on the survey?
Add the first responders up there?
I believe I do.
All under the agencies. You got a volunteer fire, volunteer dependent, paid combination.
What level of care, CFR?
One or both, either one. That'd be under your primary agency.
I'm sorry, what am I missing?
How can you be a, you can't be a CFR if you're not either independent, fire, or a combination service.
I understand, but is that a fire?
Are you looking?
There are volunteer fire department ambulances, and there are volunteer fire department first responders.
Are you looking for transport?
Right, so what's your agency, fire department first responders?
Fire department.
So volunteer fire, you check that out.
Okay, I'm just looking at, you know, we have different people that are in there, and, you know, I run BLS with tiers as well. But, you know, some people don't run with an agency enough, an ambulance at all. So, let's break that out and see what we've got in there.
So you're saying you want a transport versus BLS FR, or first responders?
Another category?
Another category?
Primary agency, let's get first responders.
First response can be advanced or BLS.
Well, a first responder can be anything listed there.
Right.
Exactly.
Right.
So what you're, yeah.
That's what I'm saying, it's already there unless you want to specify transport versus first response.
Exactly.
So you want volunteer fire ambulance and then volunteer first responder?
Exactly.
Okay.
I don't think there's any independent first responders out there.
Is Alcan still functioning?
St. Mark's,
University.
Yeah, yes, all the universities.
Yeah,
so that would all count. Yeah, so they're independent, they'd be first responders, independent,
That's what it looks good.
Anything else from the floor on your new business?
Just as a point of information, a couple weeks ago we did a hospital drill with the local radio amateur civil emergency service. We communicated between all the hospitals in the two counties over ham radio. This is our ultimate backup plan when the internet goes down, when the phone lines go down, when your cell phone goes down, we can still talk and we can. So that's something that's out there, something I've been pushing right along. If you've got space on a tower or on an elevated structure, especially the independent squads, but the fire departments as well, work with us, get an antenna in the air. You don't have to put a radio in, just get a place we can hook one up, especially if you're in a position where communications could be an issue. Like I said, we talked to Lewis County, all three hospitals, in Jefferson County. We can get to Governor Moore easily enough. So it's something that's there, it's a possibility that's there, and we're actually going to start working south. We're going to start working out towards Syracuse, making that communication as well.
How far north in St. Lawrence County do you guys go?
Well, depends on what your computer on. We go to Messina, talk to Messina every day from my house. Once we get repeater at Copenhagen back up in here, we're supposed to move top all the way from, almost from Ottawa to Syracuse.
Are you
in the group? Who? Mel? No, I don't think. No, he's a ham. He's not part of our group. He's actually, he's a member of the Osvaldo group. We have the Craig and everything.
What else do we have?
Any other new business? Our next meeting is scheduled for June 5th. Motion to close the meeting. Second. Very good. We need this voting. Good night.